The Paris 2024 Olympics is just around the corner, and so we decided to investigate how Australians plan on engaging with this year's Olympic Games. We asked questions like, will they be watching? What sports are they most interested in tuning into? And will they be watching alone or with other people? So, joining me today to discuss some of these latest insights is McCrindle's research specialist, Anna Colthorpe. Anna, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks for having me, Ash. It's good to be back.
And I should have said in the introduction, not just our research specialist, our media research specialist. So you work very closely with some PR agencies and with myself and some of the other team around, I guess, trying to discern topics and questions that the media are going to take and keen interest in. And I've been doing that for some time, and you've kind of taken it to a next level in terms of what's the topical topics and conversation, what's interesting and of the moment. And nothing's really more of the moment currently than the Olympic Games, which, as I said, are right around the corner. So Anne, I'd love for you to, I guess, just give an overview to our listeners of what this research uncovered about how Australians plan on engaging with the Olympics this year.
Yeah, like you said, Ash, very topical and definitely a fun part of our role, I feel. Like, we get to investigate Australians and how they're with the pulse of their, you know, national pride and how they're going to watch the Olympics. So it's really exciting. But overall, we found 3 in 5 are looking forward to watching the Olympics this year. And just under half of overseas are planning to watch the Olympics or follow closely each day. And a similar proportion, more than half, make it a point to watch events where Australians are competing, and a quarter are actually planning on hosting a watch party for the Olympics. And I don't know about you, but last Olympics I was heavily invested. We had ample time and opportunity to watch them as we were most likely in lockdown watching along, and I think it's great this year that we have, you know, a new kind of refreshed opportunity to be together, to watch it together, to really harness our national competitiveness as we watch along the Australian athletes competing in Paris.
Yeah, absolutely. It was really interesting to see, I guess, these results. I mean, I guess for me, I was like, yeah, like, Australians love the Olympics. We're pretty strong in some sports. We punch above our weight. Like, and that's reflected in some of the sports that people are interested in watching, which we'll get to in a moment. But yeah, it was really interesting. And I have delivered some commentary on this, and we've chatted in the office as well, I think earlier today, just around that, like you mentioned, that last experience of the Olympics. And in some ways, I think that maybe it actually did a bit of a favor for the global audience in terms of being at home. And in Sydney, we were in, I think, that really long lockdown in 2021 because it was happening not even in the original year of 2020, but in a year later in 2021 with no crowds and that really silent like experience. And yet that would have been so hard for the athletes. But in terms of tuning in at home, it's never been easier because, I mean, we were all just at home. And I remember my husband was not able to work at that time. He works in construction, and they had a bit of a break. And I'm like, this is great. We can watch together at lunchtime. And it was just a wholesome time watching the Olympics. So I wonder if you think that that has borne an impact as well on, I guess, these results where Australians, and particularly younger Australians, taking a keen interest in this year's Olympics.
I think so. I think we found in the research Gen Z are most likely to host a watch party. And I think, you know, they were naturally 4 years younger, so early 20s now, a bit older. They're the key generation we found to, you know, harness the event and come together. And I think, like that, they're also the generation most likely to prefer watching it with friends and family. On top of watching it together, I also find it interesting, or will find it interesting, I think, because I remember from last time the athletes weren't allowed to have visitors and guests. It was just online, wasn't it? It wasn't very like, there was no audiences at Tokyo. It was very like just who needed to be there. Whereas this year you'll see like the audiences and everyone getting amongst it and the cheering and everything like that. So I just wonder, like, in comparison, how different it will be and how much more excited people will be, because we have, it's almost essentially been 8 years since we've had that true, authentic Olympic experience, I wonder.
Yeah, for sure. And I know that the study we looked at as well, like the benefits or the perceived benefits anyway of the hosting the Olympics. And yeah, in the experience or in the eyes of Australians, almost two-thirds strongly or somewhat agree that hosting the Olympics has a positive impact on the host city and its residents. And yeah, you mentioning then about Tokyo and the fact that they couldn't have that, like that would have been really hard, I think, because there's a lot of investment, of course, that goes into hosting an event like the Olympics. And then the host country hopefully gets some economic benefits from drawing tourists and visitors to the country. So that would have been a challenge. But in terms of the games itself, yeah, it was a weird, unique time, COVID, in so many ways, and even for the Olympic Games. And I think for me, that was also another one of those moments when they cancelled the Olympics, I was like, okay, this COVID thing's a big deal.
Yes, I know, right? It was like, whoa, this is literally a global event now. Like they've put off the Olympics. And it kind of worked in our favor because we got to watch them at home so thoroughly invested the later year. But still at the same time, it was just, I just remember feeling not fear, but just like, okay, this is legit, this COVID pandemic, and for them to postpone the Olympics like they did, and even the last games, it just still had that flavor of, you know, naturally of the pandemic. And so this year without it, and I know in general the masks and things that aren't as apparent, so it'd just be such a, you know, contrast between the two games, I think.
Yeah, and for those younger athletes maybe for whom Tokyo was like their first Olympics, I feel like, yeah, they're probably going to get a far more authentic experience. And I mean, we were chatting actually off mic because we're of quite a similar age, and even the benefits of hosting, like, you know, the Olympics back in the year 2000 for us being Sydney-siders, and just the buzz, and we were quite young at that stage, but I remember going to see the Olympic torch, like, being run past. So it was interesting. And you alluded to that just a moment ago, even just the trend we've seen in this data about younger generations and generations that are wanting to host watch parties. And I'm older than a Gen Z, but I want to host a watch party to watch the Matildas. And I feel like maybe that's also, and someone, a radio commentator, actually mentioned this to me recently in an interview I did about this. They were like, oh, the rise of the watch parties, that's something that was maybe born out of like the Matildas, or not born out of, but further kind of encouraged and developed because we had lots of watch parties. And I guess a watch party isn't a new thing. Like, sport brings people together, whether it's like a State of Origin watch party or another kind of World Cup phenomenon, or you know, soccer match. We've had those more recently, and you know, the watch party is not something new. But yeah, it's interesting to see that the younger generations are really leaning into that. And part of me also was thinking, oh, the Olympics, like, you know, it's got this long legacy. How do they remain relevant for younger generations? And I think that experience of the last Olympics in that strange time where we were all at home and we needed something to unite us and look forward to probably helped in establishing a relevance for the younger generation. So it's interesting to see that.
Yes.
But the other thing we looked at was the different sports that people are interested in watching. And I wonder if you could give us the top results, because I wasn't surprised, but it's interesting.
Yes. No surprise, as you said, swimming is the most anticipated sport by Australians, followed by athletics and artistic gymnastics. Gen Zs are most looking forward to watching the basketball. And we were talking again about that off mic, where some younger Gen Zs are actually following the NBA outside of the Olympics. And so they're, I imagine, wanting to watch all the players that they know well at the Olympics and see them there. Artistic gymnastics is the sport Gen Y or millennials are most looking forward to. And I think of figures like Simone Biles, who have become a figure and prominence in the media. I imagine this generation is looking forward to people like that and our own Australian athletes. And Gen X and baby boomers are most looking forward to watching the swimming. And a event that Australians typically do well at. And I think of Ariane Titmus. It was last Olympics. It was her coach's amazing reaction that just swept the nation. It was fabulous to see. So I personally am also looking forward to seeing her compete again, because I know her coach's response was so fantastic. So, seeing her there again will be, I'm looking forward to.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I think I've mentioned this just a moment ago, like I'm such a fangirl of the Matildas, and I'm like, I like when they released the dates, I was like, all right, like I want to host a watch party. Like I want to do this. But then I was like, oh, they're playing at like 5 a.m. I think the first game. And I'm like, okay, that's not super conducive to a watch party. Like maybe I can like invite friends over and bribe them with like coffee and croissants or something to like make it fun. Because
yeah, very French.
Very exactly. Oh, I didn't even think of that. Okay, perfect. Lock that in. But I think like it's exciting. And I was interested, I was surprised that I guess the soccer or the football wasn't higher on the list. And maybe because we put football in the responses, which is how it's known globally. And that's very true to the schedule, but we call it soccer here in Australia. So I was like, I wonder maybe if that was a bit of a hypothesis, why it didn't get featured. Do you have any reflections? Were you surprised by that, Anne?
I just wonder if Australians just put a couple of things together so naturally, like swimming and Olympics and athletics and Olympics. They just put it together so naturally, because when I think of the Matildas, they've gained such a, you know, great figure online with TikTok and things. They're really developing their own brand and themselves, and I see them almost separate to the Olympics, and I think that'll be an added bonus because we get to see them so often outside of that, but it's also a bonus that they are also at the Olympics. And I think not just the Matildas as their own, you know, social personality online that we see, but also the other ones that we get to see behind the scenes. And I think that'll be a really cool aspect of this year's Olympics, that people are joining to watch the Olympics, and they're also seeing the athletes get ready, and they're also seeing like what's happening behind the scenes, and they're also getting to know the soccer players like we do for the Matildas as well. So I think that'll be a cool part, watching the TikToks and everything that come from it too.
Oh, for sure. We were actually only talking about this the other day around the office lunch table, about how social media has really transformed like professional sport, and like how much you want to see and how much we're used to seeing, the behind the scenes and the getting ready, like the get ready with me for the Olympics. Like we're just, it's like behind the curtain, whereas before it was advertisement and what, you know, was shown, whereas we get so much more awareness of people and elites and elite athletes and professionals, you know, personalities. And the Matildas is like a masterclass in social media and you know, developing, I guess, content for that audience, not just about the sport itself, but about the antics between the team and the team building and the personas that they're kind of building of the different players. So, yeah, it's interesting. And even just the watching element or the engagement with sport today and with something like the Olympics, it only comes around every 4 years, that kind of unites all of us Aussies together. Like it really does kind of, it has changed, I think, how we engage with it.
Yeah, I think so. And I think as well, as time goes on, I love seeing how the characters come to mind, but they're obviously people, but the brand that they develop online, on their social media, that you start to get to know over time. And I was looking actually at the stats of this year's Olympic team, which I found really interesting. So this year is set to be Australia's third largest Olympic team, comprising of 460 athletes. Wow. They're covering 33 sports. Not far behind was the Tokyo 2020 Australian Olympic team, which had 486, and then in Sydney 2000 was the largest team with 632 Australian athletes. I love that this year, it's literally a century, 100 years since the Paris 1924. More than half of the team this year will be represented by women, where in comparison to 1924, there were no women Australian athletes. This year, the youngest athlete is aged 14, and her name's Arissa True, who is competing in skateboarding, and Shane Rose, who is 51, the eldest athlete competing in equestrian. 10 Indigenous Australian athletes will also make up this year's team. And I, on top of the traditional Olympic sports in Paris this year, they'll also have sport climbing, surfing and skateboarding, and breaking, or otherwise known as breakdancing, is having its debut at this year's Olympics. So I thought that was really cool insights just about the nature of this year's team. on top of everything else.
Yeah, fun facts about the Olympics with Anne. I love it. I didn't know like any of that. That's amazing. And I feel like, I mean, maybe I'm just more attuned to it because I am a woman, but I feel like, you know, even women in the pool, like the women individual athletes at the 2020 Olympics, like they just dominated. Like you've got your Emma McKeons and your Arnie Titmuses. Like there's just, and now we've got the Matildas and we've got like so many incredible, amazing female athletes. So it's incredible to see that comparison across 100 years ago. Like that's wild. Yes. So cool.
So cool. Hey,
we love to see it. And even just, I guess, the differences over time, but like you mentioned there with newer kind of sports, like the breakdancing and the skateboarding, like I think it's fascinating because when you were talking about the different generations and the proportion, or not the proportion, but the order of the sports they are most interested in watching. So for all Australians, swimming comes out number one. And that's largely because the baby boomers kind of selected that. It was 51% of baby boomers said swimming was the sport they were most likely to engage with. So really, I guess, like you've probably got less variety in sports for older generations, whereas with Generation Z, basketball is number one as the sport they're most interested in watching, but that's only 28% of Gen Z who selected that. So it's interesting, I guess, you've got younger generations because with more diverse interests because we've got more sports, whereas for the baby boomers who've lived through a lot of Olympic Games in the past, there's hasn't been as much variety, whereas as time goes on, we introduce more sports, we introduce breakdancing of all things. So it's really interesting to see that.
Yeah, definitely. And I think in the write-up that I read, the intention for putting those sports into this year's selection of sports was to engage those younger audiences. And I think, I think it's just a great reflection of Gen Z and who they are. They're just so diverse in their interests. And it's cool that the Olympics are recognizing that.
Yeah, absolutely. They've done a great job in remaining relevant for future generations. And that's always that challenge we find, the tension of organizations or associations or codes or whatever it might be who've got a long legacy. It's like, how do they honor that legacy while also pivoting or innovating so that they do remain relevant for newer generations coming through? So it's great to see the Olympics is doing that. And that's, I think, what our research has uncovered. As we think about the future, as we look ahead to, you know, an Olympic Games being held here on Australian soil in a couple of years' time, what do you think these insights reveal, Anne, about the culture of sport and national pride here in Australia?
I think overall Australians, you know, really boast in the Australian athletes that we see at the Olympics. We found Australians are feeling that sense of national pride, with 3 in 5 experiencing this when they watch Australians compete. We also found that globally, 7 in 10 Australians agree the Olympics bring together people and create a sense of global unity. And 64% of Australians agree hosting the Olympics has a positive impact on the host city, as we mentioned before. And I think, you know, in light of 2032, it's really cool to see that they recognize what it does for the host nation as well as city. And I get the sense that Australians will be completely on board and just excited, really backing our athletes, really backing what the Games is about, bringing together global cohesion and just being such an integral part of, you know, bolstering up the pride and the competitiveness and also the good nature that the Olympics bring outside of the actual sports and events. It's the unity that unites us, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, I think it's really encouraging, of course, to think about, and in light of all these insights that we've uncovered through this study, yeah, the positive kind of reception of the Olympics and the perception of the host country. And I know that doesn't come as well without expectations. I know we did uncover some of that in the research as well around, yeah, people saying that, you know, the host country does need to kind of be sustainable. And there is, I think it was 73% of our respondents or Australian respondents said it's important for the host city to consider the environmental and sustainability efforts whilst hosting the Olympics. So it, with, you know, great opportunity comes this great, I guess, responsibility for the host nation particularly. And like you mentioned, as we look forward to 2032 in Brisbane and all the work that's already going into hosting that and preparing for that, even though feels like a while away, but yeah, it's really exciting to see that there's this great engagement with it, and it'd be fun to see all the watch parties and maybe yes. like pubs and clubs filled with people if they're watching, you know, particular sports or codes where Australians are competing and doing well in.
Absolutely. I'm really looking forward to seeing how Australians respond. Looking forward to the memes, of course, all the reactions and things that come out of it, as it always does. And just feeling so connected to the games, even though we're still at home, and how Australian athletes fare in their sessions that they're competing in.
Yeah, it's been a really fun little research piece that we've put out, yes. very timely, very interesting. So thank you so much, Anne, for your work on this research and for coming on the podcast today.
Thanks for having me, Ash. Great to be here.
And if anyone is interested, we do have a little infographic summary of some of these insights, and we've written up an article on the article section of our website. So you can always stay up to date with our latest insights by heading to our website, which is McCrindle.com. You can also subscribe to the podcast, and you can follow us on social media. So as always, thank you for listening, and bye for now.